Okay, everybody, let's get started. So just coming in, go ahead and grab a seat. Definitely more costumes than I was expecting. I was expecting zero, but respect those who showed up. Initially, my favorite was the cow. I thought that was like the most confidence. But then I saw someone walk in with a donkey's head, and I don't see it anymore. Whoever had the donkey's head, that's confidence. Okay. So, we're going to finish chapter 6 today and then get started on chapter 7. And it dawned on me this week just how close we are to the end, actually. So just to give you a little bird's eye view. This week, we will be finishing chapter 7, which is the last bit of new content before the reading break. So next week, there's exam review day on the Tuesday, test 3 on Thursday, and then reading break. After that, 2 chapters left. So we're definitely over halfway. So if you're doing well, don't get complacent. Oh, the donkey's head's back. Nice. If you're doing well, you know, stay the course, don't fall behind. And if you haven't been doing well, there's still a lot of room left. The next test is worth 20% of the grade, and then the cumulative final is 30%. So still definitely room to improve. For the APA assignment, I've been marking them. Average looks to be around 8.5 or so. I may take longer to mark it than I did the written for 2 reasons. One is just there's more involved in marking, but also my supervisor and I are submitting a paper this week, so maybe a bit slower on that, but I'm plugging away on that. I also forgot to mention last class, because we were talking about System 1 and how when you practice a sport or do some kind of physical activity, it slowly moves into System 1. I was going to use that opportunity to make a public service announcement that my professor made to my class during my first year at university, which is one big thing that happens to a lot of first year students is they stop working out. Have any of you heard of Freshman 15? Yes, so I'll just mention, if any of you are looking for a new fun way to work out, and I'm not getting paid to say this, the place I go to is called Biro Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, if you're looking for a fun way to exercise and learn some self-defense. As I say, it's basically wrestling, but with chokes and stuff. So anyways, like I said, I'm not getting paid to say that, but if you're looking for something that is available. Okay, so additionally, last class, we finished up the section on drugs, but I realized I forgot to show a video. Crash Course has a great summary of basically what I said about drugs. So we'll start off with that video, and then we'll finish off the section on hypnosis, and then that'll be it for chapter 6. All right, we'll stop there. So good bit of review. Okay, so that's all that we have to talk about with regard to drugs. And the only thing I have to say about hypnosis, which we talked about last time, is we have to talk about the 2 main theories of hypnosis. I don't have too much to add to the book here. They're both testable, but the basic idea for each is pretty simple. The first family of theories is what the book calls dissociation theories. So again, we saw last time that there's good evidence that for some things, hypnosis can have measurable effects. Social copy. For example, when it comes to pain, we talked about how big meta-analysis, lots of studies, finding that hypnosis is a better pain reliever than placebo. And we saw in the video, there's even studies of the brain showing that pain areas of the brain show decreased activation in hypnosis compared to control, which is kind of interesting. And these are the 2 main theories to explain why that's the case. Dissociation theories postulate that hypnosis induces a division in consciousness. There's the part of consciousness that the person is reporting, talking about to the experimenter, and a deeper part of consciousness that's still aware of the pain, but is not connected to what the person is talking about or reporting. So that's one theory. The other theory, the social cognitive theory, builds on the idea that humans are deeply social, deeply influenceable, And it posits that we are so influenceable that we can even change our brain's receptivity to pain in response to the right kind of social influence, which of course, hypnosis is a social activity. And the social people are still, they're not saying it's not real. If you think hypnosis is BS, that would be a different theory. This theory is just saying that it's induced by social expectation and social influence. Okay. And that's all I have to say about hypnosis. So any questions either about hypnosis or anything we covered in chapter 6? Okay, so we will now move on to chapter 7. Which is about, Good question. So steroids, if you're talking about anabolic steroids, like the kind that makes you jacked or whatever, they act on the testosterone system. They're basically synthetic testosterone, but they're not in the book. I wouldn't worry about them. As far as their psychological effects, or sometimes they make you more aggressive and stuff like that, which is not surprising. It's testosterone. But yeah, that won't show up on the test. Although if you take steroids, I'll put it very politely, the part of the body that makes testosterone will shrink because it's like, hey, we don't need to exist anymore. So just keep that in mind, gentlemen, if you're ever tempted to use them. Have any of you seen the X-Men movies? You know, Wolverine, like the Hugh Jackman? He was once asked if he took steroids because he got, you know, pretty jacked. And he was on a news show, so he had to say, I'm going to put this in family-friendly terms. I had heard about the side effects of that, and I like being Wolverine, but I don't like it that much. So. Okay, so chapter 7 is on learning and adaptation. And you might think, oh, this is the chapter that's going to help me study. But that's more so chapter 8, which is on memory. This is on learning in a much more broad sense. Most of this chapter, the first kind of two-thirds or so, is about the kind of research that the behaviorists did, kind of classical and operant conditioning experiments. And then the last third to half of the book is about other types of learning that the critics of behaviorism discovered. There are various types of learning that posed a big problem for the core assumptions of the behaviorists. And just to remind you from chapter 1, the behaviorists had three core assumptions. The first one being we should only study behavior. That's where the term behaviorist comes from. Number two, anyone remember number two?
Humans are blank slates.
Humans are blank slates. So in other words, it's all environmental shaping. There's nothing kind of genetically built in. And number three, does anyone remember number three? Sorry? Yes, about conditioning. So the third one is that the way that the environment shapes us is through conditioning. And two types are we talking a lot about? Classical, which I didn't stress the types very much in chapter one. I think I just said conditioning. But the types are, the types that they care about are classical and operant conditioning. And I will be beating those two terms into your heads. Who knows? They might even be on the written. Okay, so the way in which the book defines learning is it is a process by which experience produces a relatively enduring change in the organism's behavior or capacities. So if experience changes your behavior or your abilities, that counts as learning. It need not be conscious retention of information. In ordinary language, we may use the term learning that way, but the way the book uses learning is more broad. This, of course, makes it easier to study it in animals. And the behaviorists thought that we were actually not all that different from animals. They thought that the basic principles that you can discover when doing experiments on rats or pigeons, that the same principles govern how we behave. And I was going to say that there's a bit of a paradox with the behaviorists. I think I mentioned this in passing in chapter one. On the one hand, almost no one buys all three of these claims today. There's almost no one who would identify as a behaviorist in this strong sense. Following the 50s and 60s, behaviorism fell very much out of favor. But the work they did for category three is some of the best work done in psychology. Very rigorous work, well replicated. These two are absolutely real processes that explain a lot of interesting behavior. And also note that behaviorism was important as a reaction against some of the excesses that came before. And that's often true of intellectual movements. Often the most important contribution of a movement is its criticism of what came before. The behaviorists came after people like James and especially Freud, who kind of were going crazy, and the behaviorists insisted on being precise, focusing on what's measurable and observable. And that was, even though they maybe took it too far, I think that was an important response or reaction to what came before. I know this is mostly review, but any questions on the three core claims? Okay. The first two kinds of learning, I'll just say a little bit about. Most of the first half is, as I say, about classical and operant conditioning. But there's two other kinds of learning that I'll just briefly talk about, and that's habituation and sensitization. These are two different responses that you can get to repeated instances of a stimulus. Habituation, we actually already talked about in chapter 5. This is when you get used to something. So remember my phone example, right? Many of you, most of you probably, have a phone in your pocket. And before I said that, you weren't really thinking about it. It's not really drawing your attention very much. That's because you've become habituated to it through the course of the morning. If you were to put it in the other pocket, all of a sudden, you're going to be a bit more aware of it, right? It's going to impress more on your leg than it was in the other pocket. But then after a while, you'll kind of forget about that, too. Yes?
Would people with, like, sensory-type issues have, like, issues with, like, habituating things then? Like, if they're, like, constantly, like, having issues with like, sensory stuff and they're always, like, noticing it?
That's an excellent question. I have no idea. It makes sense to me, but I'm sure there's a paper on that. Yeah, I mean, because I know people, like, who are on the autism spectrum often have very rigid thinking, and they have sensory issues. Maybe there is a connection there. Maybe they're less good at habituating. But I don't know if that's true. That's just a conjecture on my part. But yeah, so that's habituation, kind of getting used to stimuli. You can have animals do this in measurable ways. Sensitization is sort of the opposite. And for certain kinds of aversive or painful stimuli, you can get the opposite. You can get it where with each repetition of the stimulus, you get more sensitive to it. So if you're in a room with like a loud aversive noise, even if it stays the same volume over and over again, often you become more averse to it. It kind of becomes torturous. So you can get that in animals too with electric shocks or, as I say, loud aversive noises. Sometimes if you repeat it over and over again, you become more sensitive to it, not less. Okay, now we'll get into the meat and potatoes, classical conditioning. So this is partly review from chapter one, but we're gonna go in much more depth now. Does anyone remember the guy who discovered classical conditioning? Great white beard, Russian guy?
Pavlov.
Yes, so Ivan Pavlov. By the way, I don't know if I told this story, but before I took my first psychology class, I was a little hesitant. I was just like, I don't know, it might be interesting. And I asked my mother, should I take psychology? Did you ever take it in college? And she said, oh yeah, I took one psych class. All you learn about is Pavlov's dogs. That was all she remembered. Good thing I didn't listen to her, but it worked out. But yes, it is an important finding. So what Pavlov discovered is that dogs would salivate to things that were paired with food. So initially, the dog would only salivate in response to the food that was presented, but if he would, for example, ring a bell, then give the dog food, ring a bell, then give the dog food, etc., eventually the dog would salivate just to the bell. And this was actually discovered by accident. At first, the dog would just start drooling whenever he walked into the lab. He's like, what's going on here? He kind of guessed, oh, the dog must be associating my entrance with the food. So then he did more systematic experiments with different kinds of noises and stimuli, and found that he could pair basically anything with the food and make the dog salivate just to the thing he had shown to the dog. There are five ingredients of classical conditioning. These may be on the test. Hint, hint. And these are the five basic ingredients. The unconditioned stimulus. The conditioned response. Or sorry, the unconditioned response. I'll go in so that makes sense. Unconditioned response. The neutral stimulus, the neutral stimulus will then become the conditioned stimulus. These will actually be the same thing. And the conditioned response. Let's go through these carefully. Unconditioned stimulus. Unconditioned means conditioning not required. In both these cases, actually. That's what conditioning, unconditioned means. And stimulus means something that's presented to the organism that stimulates it, that produces a response. Or maybe don't think of that. Just something that's shown to the animal, something outside the animal. So the unconditioned stimulus is something shown to the organism that produces a response without conditioning. It just naturally produces a response. So in the Pavlov's dog case, it's food. You do not have to condition a dog to salivate to food. You give food to a puppy, and it'll salivate, right? No conditioning required, yes. The behaviorist might answer that differently than I would. All I'll say is don't worry about that. Let's put it this way. It doesn't require condition on the part of the experimenter. The animal comes in with it already in place. Good question there. In this case, it's the food. And then the unconditioned response is the response produced by the unconditioned stimulus. So in this case, salivating to the food. That would be the unconditioned response in the Pavlov's dog case. The neutral stimulus is the thing that you want to condition the animal to respond to. So it starts out being neutral. It doesn't do anything. So in this case, it's the bell. So the bell is the thing you're pairing with the food to make it produce a response. After you pair the food and the bell over and over again, the bell graduates conditioning school and becomes the conditioned stimulus. So once the bell is producing salivation on its own, then it's the conditioned stimulus. You can probably guess the conditioned response is the salivation when it's in response to the conditioned stimulus. So if the dog's salivating to the bell, that's the conditioned response. So those are the basic ingredients of Pavlovian classical conditioning. Any questions about these five?
Is a neutral stimulus just like an unrelated thing that you're trying to pair with, like a natural thing?
Yeah, you're trying to pair it with the unconditioned stimulus. So it could be anything. So, and Pavlov did it with other things. He did it with like a bright light, with other noises, and yeah, you could basically take anything, pair it with the unconditioned stimulus, and then that neutral stimulus, the bell or the noise or light or whatever, would eventually produce the response on its own. Oh, good. So we'll talk about that in a bit. Basically, the way to do it is to present the bell over and over again without the food. Eventually, the conditioning goes extinct. But you have to do that. You can't just, time doesn't take it away. You have to actually expose yourself. We're going to see later this is relevant to conditioning used in therapy. So if you have some kind of conditioned association, like a phobia, like you had some traumatic experience with, I don't know, dogs or some random thing and you're afraid of it, time doesn't take it away. What you have to do is expose yourself to the thing you're afraid of over and over again and realize, oh, it's actually fine, and let the association go extinct. We're going to talk about that later. So that's, do you have a follow-up?
Yeah, so is that kind of similar to like trauma responses where
yeah, exactly. This is kind of the foundation of exposure therapy, right? Is that you need to expose yourself to the thing in question. In order to kind of decouple that association. Other questions? Okay, we're now gonna do a live demo of classical conditioning. I'm gonna need a volunteer, but you will be sprayed in the face with a water gun. I did bring a clean towel too, sure. So for those of you who did make it today, so what I did was I played a noise and sprayed the person with the water. So noise, water, and by the end she winced just to the noise. So what's the unconditioned stimulus in this case? Speak up. The water gun, right. Yep. Getting sprayed in the face with water, aversive. No one conditioned her to be averse to that. That's just instinct. What's the unconditioned response? The wincing. Yeah, good. And the neutral stimulus? The sound, right? The sound, no conditioning initially, it's just a normal noise. Conditioned stimulus? It's the sound after the conditioning is over. And then conditioned response? The wincing to the sound, yes. And if this hypothetically was in the written, you would have to specify that. The book that I used, actually I'll leave this up for now. The book that I used for undergrad, the one that I studied from, had a really funny example of this that I've never gotten out of my head. Apparently there was a guy who was with a girl and she loved eating onions. So she always ate onions and every time they were together, she had onion breath and then eventually his heart would speed up whenever he smelled the onions. So very funny example of classical conditioning at work. Okay, actually I will have to erase this. So any questions before we move on to extinction and spontaneous recovery? Okay. So someone asked about exposure therapy and that kind of thing. So here's how it works. So before this dotted line, this is when you stop pairing them. So if I was to bring this person back and I wanted to cure her of her new phobia of iPhone alarms, I would repeatedly play the iPhone alarm without the water gun. So that's going to be after here. And this line corresponds to how much, let's say in this case, she winces in response to the bell before the water gun's even sprayed. Or if you want to think about Pavlov's case, this could be how much the dog salivates before the food comes, just to the bell. So initially, not at all, of course. With repeated pairings, it goes up. But then Pavlov thinks, okay, I've messed these dogs up enough. Let's just ring the bell on its own to kind of get rid of this weird association. So then you'll get, slowly get extinction. This, as I'll say later, is the foundation of exposure therapy. Unfortunately though, especially if you wait a day or whatever, you can get a spontaneous recovery. So later you ring the bell again. Are you giving the towel back? Oh, yeah, no worries. No problem. So this is extinction and this is spontaneous recovery. Perfect timing. And as I was saying earlier though, in order for extinction to occur, you need to expose yourself to the conditioned stimulus on its own. Time doesn't get rid of the association. Okay. Any questions on these two terms? Pretty simple idea, but anything I can clear up?
Now, what happens during the recovery, I reintroduce the unconditioned stimulus?
Well, then you'll condition it back. Yeah.
Okay. What is like spike up or?
I don't know if the pattern is different. I would definitely guess that it's easier to relearn an association. That's true in the context of memorization, kind of a relearning effect. I don't know of the experiments, but I would definitely guess that it would be easier to condition it a second time. So before I talk about generalization and discrimination, we're gonna watch a video. This is of John Watson. So you may remember him from chapter one. He was the founder of behaviorism. And he did this kind of messed up study that we would never do today. With a baby known as Little Albert. And basically what they did was they just gave Little Albert phobias of white furry things. They would show him like little white mice that he liked and then bang two bars above his head. I mean, they wouldn't hit him, but they would just make like a really scary noise. And then Little Albert developed a fear of little white mice. But as we'll see, it's a bit more interesting than that. So watch this kind of sad video, but... Okay. I mean, I was always curious about the end because I don't know if they did the mask before and after, but the point is still there, right? It was very easy to condition Little Albert to be afraid of little white fuzzy things. But this is an example of what the book calls generalization. This is where you have a conditioned response not just to the conditioned stimulus, but also to things similar to the conditioned stimulus. Yes?
So since it became generalized, like I know I don't think they actually did reverse it, but how could you reverse something like that if it became so generalized and basically literally every furry thing he saw made him scared?
Yeah, I mean, one thing that goes along with exposure therapy is training and relaxation techniques, so you can associate it with that. That definitely speeds up. I bet you could even get extinction in this case. It might just be a bit harder. But one thing that's used in exposure therapy is that, to kind of speed up the process. But good question. Yeah.
Do you know what happened to little Albert?
They at least had the decency to anonymize him. I don't think Albert's even his real name. No one knows what happened to little Albert. Maybe one of you can do some investigative looking into it.
I'm pretty sure he died really young.
Oh, he did? Oh,
yeah.
You guys know more than me. Oh, okay. I don't think it would be because of that.
I think it was just coincidence.
Just coincidence? Okay.
I don't think this experiment was too ethical. It was the nurse, like the mom, had no clue what was happening to the baby.
Oh, I didn't even know that. Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
And then little Albert died at like 7, I recall.
Oh, okay.
Due to some disease or whatever, so that's why they used it.
There you go. Okay, well, so this story's even sadder than it first appeared. I mean, at least he didn't grow up to be messed up. No, that's terrible. I was going to say that. Now I've lost my thought, but so this is an example of generalization. When he's scared of like the dog and the fur coat and all that, basically in his brain he's like, anything that's like fuzzy is now scary. That's kind of the generalization he made. The kind of opposite process is discrimination. And discrimination here is not like gender discrimination or racial discrimination. This means it's using the word discriminate in the sense of telling the difference between things, right? Discriminating in that sense. Yes?
Right,
I would bet so, yes. Just because, yeah, it's, you know, it's better to err on the safe side. We have lots of tendencies for learning and for getting scared that are designed kind of to err on the safe side. I don't know of evolutionary studies on generalization, but one example that I've used in some of my work is there's evidence that our default, whenever there's like an ambiguous stimulus, is to assume that it's an agent, to assume it's another person or an animal, something that's alive. And the thinking is, look, if it's ambiguous, it's good for the brain to kind of err on the side of caution. So if there's a rustling in the leaves, it could be a tiger or it could be just the wind, but your brain's like, we're gonna assume it's a tiger. So if you're ever walking at night, you'll kind of notice that if something snaps, your automatic instinctive reaction is that's alive. And then you correct if need be. And the evolutionary logic there is just that, you know, let's say there's two guys. One guy has a genetic predisposition to always think it's an animal. The other guy has a genetic predisposition to think, maybe it's the wind. The wind guy's gonna be right sometimes, but when he's wrong, he's lunch. And then he doesn't pass on his genes. So we are sort of evolved to err on the side of assuming it's an animal. And there could be a similar kind of evolutionary logic here, as this person said. That's going beyond the book, though. You don't need to write down the stuff about the rustling in the leaves. Any other questions? Or I guess I didn't get to discrimination. So for discrimination, as I was saying, this is discriminating in the sense of being able to tell the difference between things. So suppose they brought in, I don't know if they did this, but suppose they brought into little Albert a reptile, like a little lizard or something, and let's say he's not afraid of that, he's only afraid of fuzzy, hairy things, then he's discriminating. He's like, okay, I'm scared of, you know, the white, furry things, but not smooth, scaly things, whatever. That would be discriminating. Any other questions on those? Exactly.
Okay.
Yep. Yeah, well said. Any other questions? Next. Higher order conditioning. Don't have too much to say about this. This is just when you pair a conditioned stimulus with a new neutral stimulus. So standard classical conditioning, you have an unconditioned stimulus. So like in Pavlov's case, you know, the food, right? The food is paired with the bell, and the bell is the neutral stimulus. Eventually the bell graduates and becomes the conditioned stimulus. Okay, so now the bell makes the dog drool on its own. What you could do then is pair the bell with something. So you go like bell, snap, and then make the snap into a new conditioned stimulus. Obviously you have to do this before the bell goes extinct, before it stops producing the response, but in that kind of golden zone, you could take the conditioned stimulus and pair it with a new neutral stimulus. Okay. So next, we will talk about some applications, some ways in which this can be used for good, instead of for making babies afraid of rats. So one way in which this can be used for good that I've already mentioned in response to a few questions is exposure therapy. And the idea here is probably a lot of our phobias emerge from conditioning. At least the behaviorists thought that. We'll see later that there's a genetically inbuilt part of developing phobias, but the behaviorists certainly didn't think that. They thought there was all conditioning, so you know, you have a few traumatic experiences with a certain thing, and then you develop a phobia of that thing. So the way exposure therapy works is, typically if it's with a human, you first teach them some kind of relaxation technique, like meditation or something, get them able to relax themselves, and then you slowly expose them to the thing that they're afraid of, and at each step, you kind of let them get used to it. You let the association go extinct. So let's say you're afraid of spiders. Here's how exposure therapy works. We bring you into the therapy room, whatever, teach you the meditation or relaxation technique. And first, you just get used to imagining spiders. So you sit in a chair, you imagine spiders, it's kind of aversive, but you do it until the thought of spiders is no longer anxiety-inducing. Then you'll have, in the next session, you'll have a spider like in the corner, right? Just in the corner of the room. You have to sit there, just be okay with it, right? At first, you're kind of averse to it, but you let extinction occur until you're okay with it. Next day, it's halfway across the room to you. You put it in like a glass thing or something so it doesn't move towards you. You get used to that, and so on until eventually you have like three spiders on you and you're like, okay, this really sucks. And then you stay with it until it no longer sucks. Some of you are wincing. Believe it or not, extremely effective. Very, very effective therapy. So if you have a phobia, I mean, you can pay a therapist $200 an hour, but basically that's what you do. It's worked for decades, and as I say, very, very effective. Kind of the reverse of this is aversion therapy. This is where you like something, but you would like to not like it, if that makes sense. You would rather not have this preference. So what you do is you want to take that thing that you like and make it produce a negative conditioned response. You want to be disgusted by the thing in question. Standard example that the book gives and that I have a video of is alcohol. Some people like alcohol, but wish they didn't like alcohol as much as they do. Some of you might be like this. It's Halloween. And there's different ways of doing it. The simple way, which the video shows, is you can actually bring people into the lab, make them drink, and then you give them something that makes them sick. Just in the lab. A more, I guess, careful way or a simple way of doing it is you give, simple's not the right word, but you can give someone a kind of substance that if they drink, it interacts with that substance to make them sick. So if you take this pill, nothing happens unless you drink. So if you drink, then you'll get sick. Or you can just do it in the lab and kind of make them get sick. So we'll watch a video that shows the that type, and then we'll come back and discuss. Okay, so good example. And I have here actually another example. And this is something I used on myself. So I used to bite my nails. And this is something you can get on Amazon for $20. Lots of advertisements today. This is called Biter Begoner. And what it is it's kind of like a clear, smellless nail polish that you just put on your nails, and it tastes like shit. So whenever you bite your nails, you have this very unpleasant experience, and through time it makes you kind of repulsed to the thought of biting your nails. So very simple example of aversion therapy as well. Yeah. Still effective, yeah. So we talk about this in more detail in 105, and I think it's chapter 17. So that's called flooding. So technically exposure therapy is an umbrella. It includes systematic desensitization, which is slow step by step, and flooding is, you know what, let's just go straight for the spiders on you. We'll just go straight to 100. Both effective. The flooding is more unpleasant, but still effective. I'm not familiar with rehabilitation centers and what they use. I'm sure many of them do. They should use it. Very effective. Yeah, good question. Any other questions? All right, so that's the end of the classical conditioning section. We will now move on to operant conditioning. So here's the basic difference. Classical conditioning is about involuntary reactions. So, you know, play the sound and it makes them wince. So I've conditioned her to wince. Or feeling disgusted by the alcohol. Ugh, I don't want to drink that. Or the dog salivating. These are all kind of automatic reactions that are prompted by a stimulus. Operant conditioning, you can think of operant like you're operating on the world. It's about voluntary behavior. And The behavior is basically defined in operant as a behavior not prompted by a stimulus. Just unprompted behavior. So operant conditioning is about rewarding and punishing those behaviors. So a reward is anything that causes the behavior to increase in frequency, or as they'll call it, a reinforcement. And a punishment is anything that makes the behavior decrease in frequency. So I'll show another video. This video will kind of summarize what we've talked about so far. It'll summarize classical conditioning and then help lead us into operant conditioning. Okay, we'll stop there. Okay, so we'll now go into operant conditioning in more depth. Some of those terms were new, so we'll be covering those as we move on through the chapter. The first term that we have to add is the law of effect. The law of effect is very simple, kind of obvious, but without it, operant conditioning makes no sense. The law of effect is basically two claims. Number one, if you do something and then something pleasant happens, you become more likely to do that thing again. Yes?
So, like the example they gave in like, the video, like, one shot, right? You have to be like conditioned
to want experience. Sure. Yeah. A lot of the examples we'll talk about involve multiple presentations, but oh, yeah, no, one can do it. Yeah, so the first part of the law of effect is if you do something and then something pleasant happens, you become more likely to do that thing again. And if you do something and something unpleasant happens, you become less likely to do that thing again. Pretty simple. Yeah?
So the pleasant and unpleasant, that's not a matter of like presence or lack?
Yeah, so like the video said, the words positive and negative do not mean good or bad in the context of operant conditioning. I'm going to be hammering that point when we get to it in a bit. But when I say pleasant or unpleasant, that does mean good or bad. So very important to keep that. Say the law of effect is very general. It's basically just actions that are followed by pleasant consequences increase in frequency. Actions followed by unpleasant consequences decrease in frequency. As I think I mentioned in a previous class, I'm currently reading Dan Dennett's intellectual autobiography. He has a funny line about this. I forget who he stole it from, but it's like an old joke, and it's kind of mean, and it's a little unfair, but it's about why are psychology majors dumb? So don't tell the department I said this, but here's how the line goes. So why are psychology majors dumb? It's because in intro psychology classes, the professor gets up and says things like, you know, when you get punished for doing things, you do them less often. 95% of the class says, well, yeah, duh. And then 5% goes, that's genius! And then they become psychology majors. So a little unfair, but in this case, kind of an obvious thing. But it is the foundation of operant conditioning. So the big name here to know, which is a name we saw in chapter one, is B.F. Skinner. He made the Skinner boxes, yes. So John Watson was the first behaviorist. His famous work was done on classical conditioning, but Skinner was the one who really made behaviorism dominant in psychology in the 30s, 40s, and a little bit into the 50s. And as the person mentioned, the Skinner box, these are these boxes in which he would keep animals, like pigeons or rats, and he would tightly control their environment, and he would reward them for doing certain things, punish them for doing others, and he would carefully vary the schedules of reinforcement or punishment and found some really interesting patterns that we'll be talking about. So the first thing we have to talk about, and this connects to the issue of positive and negative, is the four types of punishment and reinforcement. And actually, let's make sure. Actually, what does it include this? So as I've already said, and as the video said, positive and negative do not mean good and bad. They mean addition and subtraction. Right? That's the way to think about it. And then I'll just write reinforcement and punishment. Those mean, do they increase the frequency of behavior or decrease it? So then it'll break down into positive reinforcement, negative reinforcement, positive punishment, and negative punishment. Before I go through this, I want us all to say something out loud together to get it into your heads. I'm going to say a sentence, and you're all going to repeat it. Negative reinforcement is not punishment.
Negative reinforcement is not punishment.
Good. Okay, so you should all get that question right if it's on the test. Okay, so let's go through these. So positive reinforcement, so positive means addition. Reinforcement means it increases the frequency of the behavior. So you give the animal a treat or something, or some other positive, some other pleasant thing that makes them more likely to do it. So my cat does a trick, I give him a treat. That would be positive reinforcement. Negative reinforcement, so it's subtraction, but it increases the behavior. So it's hard to think of examples that aren't really cruel, but one example might be, you know, if I give my cat like a shock collar and I just shock it over and over again until it does something good. So let's say he does a trick, and then I stop electrocuting it. So I would never do this, of course, but if I take away the shock, that's negative reinforcement. A less crazy example is the one from the video of taking away the homework. So, okay, you don't have to do homework this night, so it's subtracting something, but it's rewarding. I see some looks of confusion. So, does anyone want to ask a question about this? I mean, if you think of the Skinner box example, the way they would do it is they might have like an electric pad on the bottom. Let's say it's a pigeon, and you want the pigeon to peck the green square. So you keep zapping the pigeon, and the pigeon's like freaking out. And if it pecks the square, you stop electrocuting it. That's negative reinforcement. You're subtracting the electrocution, but it is still a reinforcement, still a reward. Yes. Gets taken away, yes, exactly. Any other questions? About, because this is the weirdest one. The rest are pretty intuitive. Okay, positive punishment. So you add something. So again, I wouldn't do this, but let's say my cat does something bad and I smack it in the head or something. That would be positive punishment. I'm adding the smack, right? So it's adding something to decrease the frequency of the behavior. Negative punishment, you know, your kid misbehaves, you take away his phone. Devastating, right? So you're taking away something, but it's going to decrease them doing the behavior. Okay, we will now watch another clip. This is a clip from a very sophisticated television program of positive punishment being applied to train someone to stop doing bad things. So watch that, and then come back and move on to operant extinction. All right. Hey, very sophisticated show. Lots of philosophical insight in there. I watched a lot of SpongeBob growing up because I have three younger siblings, and there's a wide age range, and there's one girl, three boys. We're all older. And what's the one show that we could all agree on? SpongeBob. Good for all ages. Or before I erase, any last questions on this? We're going to move on to extinction. But yeah, my sister's had an interesting life with three brothers. She once made the mistake of bringing her boyfriend over, and one of the three brothers challenged him to an arm wrestle, which my brother won. And then I just mentioned in passing, I was like, hey, he's the weakest of the three of us. What do you think your chances are against all three at once? Just, you know, kind of slid that. But anyways. She just broke up with him, though. It's a great day in a man's life when your sister dumps the boyfriend. So, okay. So, operant extinction. So it's similar to extinction in classical conditioning. If the reward or punishment goes away, often the association goes away as well. So I have another example involving my brother, actually the one who arm wrestled my sister's boyfriend. So he's the youngest of the three boys. When he was a baby, my other brother and I would spend time with him, and he developed the habit of hitting himself in the face. He probably did it by accident first, but then we laughed. In my family, we're always laughing at each other. That's kind of just how it works. So my brother and I laughed, but that was positive reinforcement because my brother, even as a baby, liked to make us laugh, still does, funny guy. But he then started doing it a lot. And my mom had to be like, guys, you've got to stop laughing at this. Right? He's going to just keep hitting himself in the face. So we had to use operant extinction. We had to stop rewarding the behavior. So he'd hit himself in the face, and we'd be like, yo, just hold back the laughter. And he'd tell us, guys, come on, I thought we had a thing here. You know, keep hitting himself in the face. And eventually, he clued in that the jig was up, and it wasn't going to work. Oh, I don't know what the technical term would be for that. Wait, so it's you cheer when he's crying? Hey, every family's different, you know. Do you mean hits his head like not like mine? You mean like it falls down?
You're passing by, it hits on the wall, right?
Oh, yeah, okay. Yeah. Sorry. You're making me feel better about my family. Go ahead. Oh, I see. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
It doesn't cry. It just laughs instead.
Yeah, I don't know what you would call that. Yeah. It's definitely something. I know what you're referring to. But yeah, I don't know what the term is. But thank you, if anything, for the comedic relief. But okay. Okay. That's all I have to say. Okay. Next. Oh, this is death. Okay. So the next distinction that we have to talk about is the distinction between primary reinforcers and secondary. The distinction here is pretty simple. It's somewhat similar to the distinction between unconditioned stimuli and conditioned stimuli, but just in the context of operant conditioning. A primary reinforcer is one that does not require conditioning. So the fact that we are rewarded by sweet things or by warmth or things like that, that's just instinctive, right? You come into the world, you can put sugar on a baby's tongue and it'll like it. You can condition it just with that. For operant condition. A secondary reinforcer is one that you are conditioned to find rewarding. So most of you will find the following symbol on a piece of paper to be rewarding. You see that? That's positive reinforcement for whatever behavior you had done that semester. But no baby comes into the world just loving the look of that, right? Obviously, that's the result of learning that that's a good thing, that it's a reinforcing thing. The book has a brief discussion of delayed punishment. Delayed is not very effective, especially for animals. In some contexts, it can work for humans. I think I mentioned that I used to work with a guy who got shot in the head. Have I told this, talked about this guy? Yes. He was telling us a story once, eyebrows were up as always, and he was yelling the whole story. He's like, my dog took a shit on the floor, and when I found it, I took the dog's face, and I put it in the shit. But that's not going to work, because it was so long after that, you know, not going to work. But even with humans, there is some evidence that delayed punishment is not very effective. For example, in the context of criminal punishment, I'm not a criminologist, but the consensus among criminological experts is that certainty of punishment and immediacy of punishment is more important than severity, right? If you had two different laws, and one meant that one meant that 90% of drunk drivers would get punished quickly, but they'd only get a day in jail or something, and another one said that 10% would get punished, but they get 10 years in prison, the one that has more certainty of punishment will be more effective. So that's one kind of practical implication of this kind of work. I don't think those terms are in the key term, but that's just kind of an example of how this applies. Okay. The next thing is shaping and chaining. But I think we can stop there. Happy Halloween. I'll see you all on Thursday.